First of all, let me thank all of you for coming here, and I hope for the more engagement and for the discussion session. And I am really glad to see some of my teachers like Professor Mary John, and some of my contemporaries like Saji and Guna and all of them are sitting here. So in a way, it helps, you know, it evokes all these memories from the last decade where I spent my days here in this great institution, which is gradually, you know, I don't want to come in that sense. So anyway, so in this wider context, I mean, which I left in between without completing the sentence, which actually provides the kind of context to think about this book. Because the wider project which I am interested in is the question of democracy. How can we make the democracy working?
Maybe before, I mean,
distrust, so let me quote him,
Distrust is something which takes place on the margins of trusting systems. So from this point of view, the public's loss of trust in experts and erosion of institutional credibility were situated events embedded in a deeper system of public trust in science as a reliable system of knowledge. So this is, I would like to say, as an introduction to what I was trying to do in the book. So in no way, I mean, currently there's a debate which is going on in the context of the March for Science, where, you know, Sundar Sanyukai and some scientists are, engaged in a debate on this, about science and its social function or social function, right? For the role of science in democracy. And yesterday, I think Professor Abhijit Pathak also joined this debate from a sociology of science point of view by invoking Mertens and critiquing that particular standpoint. So in a way, when we talk about science, the question of science is not the question of science which was proposed by philosophers and especially Karl Popper. So here it is considered as a set of diffused institutions which produce different kinds of knowledges. So there is a geography which is always attached to these institutions, to the kinds of knowledges being produced. So it always exists. What science is actually a kind of, the better term which appeared in Jules' presentation and also I discussed it in the book, that is the ethno-epistemic assemblages. So it exists as that. So from a sociological, my work is from a sociological point of view and where I am looking at how science operates in the public domain, how public engages with science in their everyday life. And the method which I employed to understand this is basically a kind of ethnography where I am looking at the newspaper debates. So around these three controversies. And I'm looking at how these controversies evolve on a day-to-day basis. So each and every piece of news, all the news reports were reported for me. I mean, usually the practice within media studies and journalism studies is that you pick up a few pieces from here and there and then you do a kind of discourse analysis or a textual analysis of this text to find out meanings. But actually, in my work, I am shifting away from that particular method because I find it quite rudimentary and very limited. Rather, my attempt to create a thick description of these controversies by following the news on a day-to-day basis. So now, I mean, there are several questions which are being raised by the panelists, and I thank all of them for making the debate lively and separating the book in meticulous ways from their own disciplinary backgrounds. So let me just try to pick up some of the things which they were trying to raise here. And one important question which you was trying to repeat several times was the question of co-production of knowledge. As a title of the book. So the question of co-production of knowledge, I mean, this is a basic question which emerges from these discussions where actually, this is a kind of question raised by Professor Sheila Jasinov, where she is looking at the co-production of the knowledge about nature and the co-production of a social system in that context. So at one level, the natural and the social are co-produced. That is what's happening at that juncture of this co-production, which is happening through scientific enterprise. So this is actually very fundamental to the work which I'm trying to do. And so connecting it with Kumar's question of the kind of binary between truth and power or the technical and the political which is operating at the foundations of these public debates on science. So actually the question of truth, I mean I'm not saying that truth and power are separated, but rather within the liberal democracy paradigm, this is foundational to its operation. There is a separation of truth and power on which the liberal democracy is based upon. That's its foundation. Where the understanding is that truth is something which belongs to the domain of science. So scientific experts have the capability of producing truth, and democracies and the government or the state is dealing with, the polity is dealing with the question of power. So now the issue is that what's the connection between this truth and power? So within the liberal democracy paradigm, this truth is provided always by the experts. You know, so we do not challenge the expert. When we go to the doctor, we don't challenge his expertise. Or when if you want to construct a nuclear reactor, you know, we do not think about it in terms of democracy. Even parliament cannot debate it, right? So because it belongs to the domain of science, where experts, technical experts, can actually give the solution, or they can provide the advice. So, and then the problem is that within the democracy, the very meaning of the democracy is that it's a democratic system where we debate things, or you know, we collectively make the decision. But because of the separation between truth and power, the problem is that the expert is placed above the democracy, right? I mean, it's not a democratic system then, where the truth is offered from outside the democratic system, where the expert does not belong to the domain of democracy. So then the problem is that the technical is placed above the political. So this was the kind of foundation for liberal democracy to operate in the 1960s. But with the advent of the risk question, this particular arrangement or this particular binary started being collapsed. And now nobody, because our family doctor has been trusted to go back. You know, we always take a second opinion. And we can see that there are several public controversies which have been emerging in society. Whether it is nuclear reactors, whether it is hydroelectrical power projects, whether it is about our own body and the biology's understanding of our own body. And there are, you know, I mean, there are several kinds of issues at this intersection. And at another level, you know, this again leads to a more deeper kind of question of what Agamben tries to raise about this collapse of the separation between zoo and bios, right? I mean, with the animal life and the political life, the clear separation between that. So the state becomes, and the politics becomes, an important thing, yeah, to think about science after the 1960s. We do not have much time, so that we just go ahead with some of these issues. And then you raise this question of the performativity of science. So the theme of these two books are actually connected. We gave the title as Reason and Pleasure in Kerala's Public Sphere. So the book discussions are about how reason and pleasure works in the public domain. So in the book, I am using Irving Goffman's perspective of dramaturgy, where I am conceiving the scientific public sphere as a theater, where there's a front stage and a back stage, and there's a complex relationship between the front stage and back stage. And of course, there's an audience, and audience also influence what performance is happening on the front stage. So in a simplistic way, this is what I take as a framework to understand these public debates or science that is happening in kind of the society. And the question of science body as a matter is raised, and the role of cases. So let me just make a small introduction here. In terms of how to understand the Kerala Shastra Sahitya Parishad's role in public engagement with science. Actually, Kerala Shastra Sahitya Parishad's engagement with science was different from a technocratic understanding of science, which was very much part of the Nehruvian paradigm before that. So actually, Kerala Shastra Sahitya Parishad's contribution is to change the nature of public engagement with science from that earlier scientific point of view, where the scientists were, you know, offering technical solutions to the problems of democracy. So Parishad, in a way, actually challenged this particular issue by, of course, from a Bernardian point of view, framing it in terms of the social function of science, where the cognitive core of the science is not affected by any of these social and cultural activities, but at the same time, we should take the science is operating in a capitalist society, so we should actually, the role of the activist or the politician is to, actually take, or the role of the public is to take it out of the capitalist system, to make more socialist system, to make it as a weapon for social revolution. This was Parishad's shift in the debate or framework in the 1970s. Before that, Parishad also was subscribing to the earlier perspective. So in a way, they also made it clear that it's a fight against scientists, but at the same time, this is also a fight against a kind of romanticism, a romantic view of the environmental issues. Right? I mean, it was offered by all these Gandhians and Schumacherians who were talking about, a deep ecological point of view or a kind of, romantic understanding of science. So Parishad should be situated in that particular context to understand what Parishad was doing. And then my point is that this particular engagement was highly limited, as it is quite obvious, because it was still considering the cognitive core of science as something which is sacrosanct and which cannot be democratized, because it is beyond the question of democracy. The problem is the way this cognitive core is embedded in certain socio-economic relations. But there is, Silicon Valley is a watershed in that sense, because now there are more and more social memories coming out about the Silicon Valley struggle, where all these ecological groups are, and how these ecological groups envisioned their question. But what is available as a dominant discourse is that Parishad was the leader of the movement. So there is a plurality of perspectives which is emerging now on the particular question. So by looking at the way Parishad was engaging with science, and Parishad as the medium of public engagement with science, with the emergence of this discourse in the 1990s, you can clearly see a shift from Parishad to the newspapers as the major platform, or as the medium where this debate is happening, which actually changes the way public engagement with science is happening. So during Parishad's period, the 1960s and 70s, it was more consensual. So we can democratically, discuss it, and then we can bring in a plurality of expertise, and then we can fix the issue, we can resolve the issue. That was the kind of perspective. But this changes when media appears as the primary channel through which this debate is operating. The risk debate emerging out, actually this particular understanding is changing towards a more open and contentious form. There is a very aggressive, contentious kind of debate which is happening in the media, and often this doesn't reach a consensus. So there's a shift in the way this the public base of knowledge is existing. In the 1960s, it was the civic epistemology, that was more consensual, but after the 1990s, it has become more contentious in nature. So this is the major shift which I am trying to mark. And this is quite clear with, again, controversies which I am trying to study. I mean, in none of these controversies, Parishad appears at all. Parishad is not an actor. just in the RCC case, Parishad appears, but that also in a very marginal way. It doesn't make any impact in that sense. There are other kinds of actors and you know, other kinds of processes which actually creates it. And again, there are several questions that we stroke here with the, I mean, Christy raised the question of affect, which is something which is very, very important. And although I am not taking that as a serious question, because I am working within this discourse, and model of analysis, but this is something which is quite important, and this is something which I am scantily mentioning in the book, especially in the context of the debate on this, critical trials in the regional cancer center in Kerala, where we can see that there is a debate on the patients. I mean, there is a debate, the patients appear are always represented by the authentic legitimate actors. You know, there is a separation between the body of the patient and the concerns that body raises. Anyway, I mean, that is not a very major theme which the book of course debates. So let me just make a final point, which is about how I link the work of the analysis of the book with my contemporary work. And again, you know, I am convinced that the question of science and the state should be explored to understand a proliferation of publics at this at the intersection of the political and the scientific or the technical. Right? So in a way, you know, Christy pointed out it very well that the public, the scientific public emerging is not someone who is engaged with this debate, rather this is a public which has been constituted through these debates which is happening, debates which are happening in the scientific public sphere. So I am looking at what is the nature of the scientific public which is emerging here. So it is quite interesting in the sense that I mean this particular scientific public is imagined within the liberal democratic understanding of democracy. So there starts the problem. So what are the other kinds of publics which actually exist? So can we locate these alternative publics which are existing so that we can think about democracy beyond this deliberative model of democracy, which is considered as something which is quite radical in contemporary debate, as you all know. So even in science studies, this deliberative term is considered as something which is great, where, you know, in a galvanizing sense, we can make the participation of everyone who are actually affected by the issue, so that, you know, it can be a more democratic you know, kind of project, which in the Indian constitution is trying to develop through the concept of the cognitive science, cognitive justice as a concept. So can we go beyond this particular kind of paradigm in which we are thinking about democracy? Can we think about multiple publics who have multiple kinds of engagements with state and science possible? So this is where the book ends. So thank you again very much to all the panelists for making this discussion, taking this discussion further, and I hope there will be more interesting debate.